The Cherokees.
A thriving American Indian tribe.
Our history.
Our culture.
Our people.
Our future.
The principles of a historic nation.
Sewn into the fabric of a modern world.
Hundreds of thousands strong.
Learning. Growing.
Succeeding.
And steadfast.
In the past, we have persevered through struggle.
But the future is ours to write.
Osiyo.
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 These are the voices of the Cherokee people.
Osiyo, I'm Principal Chief Bill John Baker. Welcome to the Cherokee Nation and Osiyo TV. This is how we share our culture, our heritage, our history, and our language with you. Wado.
Osiyo, it's how we say hello in Cherokee, and welcome to the Spider Gallery in Tahlequah, Oklahoma. This is a hub for Cherokee artists whose work is on display and up for sale here. In this episode, we'll meet some Cherokee artists working in both modern and traditional forms. First, meet Bessie Russell, a basket weaver who's teaching her craft to future generations.
Okay, I'll start with who I am. I'm Bessie Russell, and I'm one of the living treasures, and I've been weaving baskets for over 40 years.
Gun or sausage is how we say it, isn't it? Gun or sausage, that means broom. They used to get all that buck brush, and they made brooms a long time ago. Gun or sausage.
If you don't know, you got to learn how to identify it first, you know, and it grows. Not tall, maybe 3 feet tall, and it grows berries, and that's the easiest way to identify it is those little berries, you know, they just kind of clusters, you know, not very big.
That's the best kind, if you can get some like that. But.
Well, I went to school at Rocky Ford. Of course, I just went up to the eighth grade, and after that, I went to school at Oaks. I hated it. Of course, when I started to school, I couldn't speak English. At home, you know, my dad could, you know, speak a little bit, but it was all kind of what they say, broken English. And my mom, she never did talk English to us, so that's all we knew. If you want to be a traditional basket maker or call yourself a traditional basket maker, then you've got to start from the bottom. First, you go gather. Then you boil it. And then you strip it. And then sometimes I even had to bleach it a little bit, you know. After that, it's just coil it up or however you want to store it, you know, until you get ready to make your basket. For one about that size, it'd probably take about 30 inches, and you cut 12 of the same length, and then you divide those into six, and then a half of one, and you cross the six together, but you always make sure that the six that's in your right hand goes over the ones that's in your left hand, or it won't come out right when you start weaving. Yeah, there's still some. There's a good one. This one?
No,
that one, yeah. That one,
this one here. Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Do they help you with this a lot?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they know just about everything I know. They know how to gather. They know how to treat it. I was asking them the other day, did I teach you how to make baskets, or did you just kind of do it on your own? They're both, I call them basket weavers because they both can do it, and as I said, they know just everything that I know as far as gathering and how to treat it and everything and get it ready for to make a basket.
So are you gonna put color in this one? Or is it gonna be?
Yeah, my granddaughter, she knows how to weave baskets. And Vicky's got a grandson that has made baskets. Yep, I've got three generations. I do a lot of things I make baskets for a while, and then I'll go back and go do something else. But here lately, it's just been mostly baskets and those beads. And the beads, I don't go out and gather it. Jane gives me the remnants. So that's where I make my beads from. But there's still lots of steps to it. Anyway, you roll them, and then you punch holes in them. I'm kind of amazed, you know, that there are still so many out there that don't know how. There's so many out there that still wants to learn. It makes me feel like, especially if I know they're really interested, you know, and want to carry on, that's really important, you know, because maybe one of these days, you know, nobody may not be around to to teach them how to do this, and there's just not very many of them that's doing the traditional read. I really feel blessed, you know, of being able to do what I do, you know, and I never dreamed that I would be doing this when I first started to school and couldn't even understand English, you know. So I'm just amazed and how things can turn out, you know. So I'm just thankful, you know, and I just have to keep going, take care of everybody else. You know?
She's known as a musician, but Kalyn Fay Barnoski is also a fine artist and graphic designer. Her work deals with the concept of identity and is heavily influenced by her Cherokee heritage.
Swayed around as if they had a secret. Wish they would have told.
I'm Kalyn Fay Barnoski. I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Actually, originally from Okemah, Oklahoma. I'm in school and getting both of my masters so I can be a professor. I know what I love to do, and I'm really passionate about what I want to do. And so I want to give that to somebody else as well. I got into art when I was like a really tiny child. I loved art and I loved music. I still feel like art is a way anyone can help someone. Mine isn't so much about just being Native as it is like trying to interact with other people who are dealing with being Native and being white and trying to fit in. It's different in Oklahoma than it is anywhere else because there's 38 plus affiliated tribes in Oklahoma. So most people you run into are going to be a little bit Native. My dad is full-blood Cherokee. All of my thesis work I'm working on right now is my Christian background versus like Native spiritualism and how my dad grew up and how he still carries a lot of those ideas and views but tries to mix them with Christianity. My family's really tight-knit. My grandma always brought us all together. She taught and spoke in Cherokee. I definitely feel like there's a connection with my grandma when I do my art. Even though she's not here, she's always been very supportive of me doing art. She's who inspired me to do the work that I'm doing. I wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't for her.
I was told I was too young to understand much about the town and how life moves. But I remember climbing up those overcome trees taking in the beauty of the view. And I still call that town my home. Though I've left and I still roam. Can't explain just how I felt. Living in the Bible Belt. Living in the Bible Belt.
I didn't start playing music till I moved towards the Tulsa area. My sound is mostly folk. I do singer-songwriter stuff. I have a new album. It's called Bible Belt. All the music I write now is like stories about people I've met or people in my life or myself. A lot of it has to do with living in Oklahoma or in the Bible Belt. I've been playing some of these songs for a few years now, and I just want to have a physical thing to give to people. I'm a part of two separate communities. I'm part of like the design art community, and then I'm part of the music community. I do all facets of design. I do poster design, I've done web design, I do any sort of print design. I like working with silkscreen the most. I made one that's kind of comical, that has a native on it, and it says, I'm part white, but I can't prove it. One of the pieces I worked on was two separate silkscreens that I sewed together, and one was of like a traditional like 50s family at a table, and the other was a group of like native men just out in the prairie. And I got some like syllabary on it too, which translates to Yosei Yagi, which means I wish I had that. It's just like a conversation about how one wishes they had the other. Like my white side wishes they had like the culture and history that my native side has. My native side almost wishes they had like this traditional like white family stability. For me, Cherokee means like community. It's not even just that, it's like retaining a heritage and pushing it further and not making it better, but always being appreciative of your history, continuing on with that. Not letting it die, but also not scared to keep progressing.
Grace and rain and sins and dust caused our bodies all to rust till we left with our bare feet. And I still call that town my home. Though I've left and I still roam. Can't explain just how I felt. Living in the Bible Belt. Can't explain just how.
Cherokee National Treasure Lorene Drywater has been making dolls out of native buffalo grass since she was a child. She's the only living person known to make these dolls, and she shared her creative process with us.
Uh-oh.
Did you break your pick?
No.
That's not a very big one.
This one?
Yeah.
But it's got long roots.
Oh, okay.
So you get all the roots together.
Uh-huh.
And just like that.
Oh.
I'm gonna scatter this a little bit, I don't, and it's a work. It is a hard work. They wanted me to teach somebody to do this, and I thought, no, that sounds easy enough, but if they want to learn how to make those buffalo grass dolls. They're gonna have to dig themselves and learn how to clean it. Because that's the only way you're gonna do it. Who wants to get out there and play with the grass? I'm the crazy one. I'm Lorene Drywater. I'm the one that makes buffalo grass dolls.
Buffalo grass dolls are a unique invention by Lorene Drywater. Lorene fine-tuned the whole doll thing to putting traditional Cherokee dresses on them with bottom parts and everything, and weaving up the roots into the hair. She's the only known grass dog maker in North America.
Mama showed me how. I was about five. I asked her, why don't they ever buy us dolls? And she said, well, because we don't have no money. So when she first taught me how to make a doll, she said, all right, come over here and I'll show you how to make your doll. You can make it yourself. Just follow my instruction. She told me what all to get together. I watched her. I paid attention to everything she done, and I've been following it since. When I want to make a doll, I'm going to go pull the grass out of the ground and wash the dirt off of it. I clean it, I wash it in a big tub of water, getting some roots ready, and so I can tie some strings on it. Hang on. This is the neck. Now this is gonna be the body. It's a broomweed. It's a that kind of stuff that grows out there in the pasture. Okay, here's a starting of one. These are her arms. The face is supposed to be right there, and the arms and the body. How does this look as a blouse? I try not to dress them all the same. And this is how it would look. Like this. Whenever they are dressed. Sewing was my favorite. I even fixed my own dress. If I tore my dress, I fixed it myself. And of course it didn't look as neat as it would if Mama did it. But Mama didn't have time. She had too many little ones.
She's a national treasure for making Cherokee tear dresses and clothes. And for her to transition into a doll form is very unique. She loves the woods and her plants, and that's what's Cherokee they like, is the woods and their plants. She applies traditional indigenous knowledge systems into her work. That's what's very unique about Lorene. She puts it all together and has a unique contemporary art form that's distinctly hers.
And this is my mom. She dressed like that. I made that dress. Everything I had, I made myself, or somebody made it. And here's my grass dolls. I was working on them. I'm just so used to doing things on my own. That's okay. They know what I do. They know what I made. And they know where to find them. So that's it.
Eddie Morrison is another Cherokee national treasure, a sculptor who studied under the famed Apache artist Alan Hauser. Here, Eddie tells us how he came to be an artist and his influences.
They call me Eddie Morrison. I am a sculptor. I am Cherokee, and I am very proud of it. So it's been a long, hard road, but I've made it this far. And hopefully I've got a little ways to go. Someday they'll find me with a chisel in my cold, dead hands, but that's who I am. Well, my stepfather was a welder. He went to welding school. And we all packed up and went to South Carolina. We went to call the bomb plant. It was the atomic energy plant down in Savannah, Georgia. I was fairly dark skinned. And when I go to school, very racist, very racist. I was beat up. I mean, I had to walk a gauntlet almost to be at school there. And I always tell people, I said, and that kind of made me gun shy. And ever since, I've always been kind of, I guess it's been a struggle to speak in front of people. Well, I lived there until I couldn't take it anymore. And I started acting out. And they brought me back to live with my grandmother here in Tahlequah. I was probably in the fourth, fifth grade, something like that. But it was a long time overcoming that. I was raised by my grandmother, and her name was Jane A. Batt. She was a full-blood Cherokee, spoke and wrote Cherokee. I would watch her piece quilts and things and make her designs in them. And I was always fascinated how she could just, think about it and cut those pieces up, then make a real beautiful quilt. And she had a sister that would come and visit when I was a small boy. And she could draw, and I was always fascinated that she could draw like that. And one of her favorite subjects was to draw panthers. And she'd tell me different stories about the panthers and different things like that. And of course, I think that influences you to be around people doing things like that.
But I'll take a stone and I'll look at it for quite a while. It's kind of like this stone here on the floor. I haven't really decided what I want to do with it, but it has a lot of potential just because of the, as I was talking about, the natural lines all ago that come across it. I can see a lot of things in that.
I could draw and do different things, so I said, well, I'll try painting. But it never really came real natural to me, and I kind of struggled with it. I picked up a piece of wood after seeing some wood carvings and stuff, and it came so natural, I couldn't believe it. And then I heard about this man named Alan Hauser, who was a famous stone sculptor.
He was going to be a guest instructor through the Art Student League of Denver. So I saved my $400 and paid for a week's training up there. Alan took me under his wing because I was the only native guy, and he knew a lot of Oklahoma artists. He knew Cecil Dick, Willard Stone, and I was quite impressed with him. He encouraged me to go on to school at Santa Fe, to the Institute of American Indian Arts. And I think that's when my career really took off. I learned a lot from him, and I always admired, even more than his art, I admired him as a man because he carried himself very well. I just think it was a blessing, really, to have met him and watched him work and had him show me and mentor me. I don't really try to win the awards anymore. Like I said, I can't compete with the new young artists, but I've won my fair share of awards over the years. And when I make a piece, I don't try to make a piece to win an award on. I make it for me and for the people I think would appreciate it. I became a Cherokee National Treasure in 2014. It was, I always tell people, I said that was the pinnacle of my career, I think. I'm very proud of that, to have been named a Cherokee National Treasure. It's a great honor, and it was something that it would take a lot to top it. I kind of grew up around people doing things with their hands and making, quilts and crocheting and carving things out of wood and just creating things with their hands. And so you're influenced by that, but a lot of times I do think it's just in your DNA too, that creating anything, I think, to me is a mystery. Where does it come from, I mean, I can look at a rock or a piece of wood and see an image in it. My work has gone all over the world, and it's just like a part of me going out somewhere. I like to think that if somebody thinks enough of my work to
take it home with them or take it somewhere that, you know, they're accepting me into their house. So I'm very proud of that. I've got work coast to coast, and I've been blessed. And I tell people it's a blessing. It's to be a, what I do, to be given a gift that I was given. I still surprise myself sometimes. I can do a piece of art. I can sit back, it'll send a cold chill down me and say, man, did I do that? So.
The Cherokee Nation has a rich heritage full of and inspired by the arts. To watch more stories of Cherokee artists, please visit our website, osiyo.tv. And now you can bring both seasons of Osiyo Voices of the Cherokee People home for the holidays on DVD. Just visit CherokeeGiftShop.com. There is no Cherokee word for goodbye. We say, Donadago Ha'i. We'll see each other again. So until next time, Wado. Coming up on Season 3 of Osiyo, Voices of the Cherokee People in 2017. Cherokee National Treasure Richard Fields teaches us how to make a traditional Cherokee bow. And it all starts by picking the right tree.
You see that? You see it looks pretty decent, but it goes like this.
Yeah.
Comes back and goes this way. That would make a good one.
And a look back in history to 1785 and the signing of the Treaty of Hopewell, the circumstances that led to the very first treaty between the Cherokee Nation and the United States government. And plenty of profiles of Cherokee Nation citizens leaving their mark on the world around them. Tune in next year for more authentic stories from the Cherokee Nation. Active teens are happy teens, so don't let sports injuries or illnesses sideline them. Tribal health benefits only cover so much, so get your teen insured with CHIP. CHIP is an additional free or low-cost insurance designed to keep your teenagers healthy. Contact Indian Healthcare Resource Center in Tulsa or visit osiyo.tv and click on links mentioned for more info.
The Cherokee Nation has a higher rate of uninsured children on both a national and state level. Injuries can arise unexpectedly, away from home, especially in athletes. With SoonerCare, children get the specialty care that they need to get back on the road to recovery. Care that Indian Health Services may not cover. Get in the game, get covered. Stop by or call your local patient benefits coordinator at any Cherokee Nation Health Center and W.W. Hastings Hospital.